This experiment actually has me a little nervous. I can see there would be a potential for an explosion. I have to be careful with this one. Hey there, welcome to FarmCraft. If you're new here, my name's John, and we are going to revisit the mixing molten metals experiment. This is a piece of copper, and this is aluminum. You mix those together, you get aluminum bronze. This is what we tried last time.
I was trying to mix copper and aluminum in a molten state to get interesting alloy patterns in the casting. While I did get a small amount of this, most of it was fairly uninteresting looking and it had a problem.
And this stuff is so brittle, it is essentially not usable to me. We ended up with a lot of an alloy that was absolutely worthless and ruined the whole thing. So, let's get rid of that. Let's get rid of that. So now, if you mix copper with tin, tin gives you bronze. I don't know if the camera picks it up. This is more golden colored. This is more of a bronzish color. Duh. So that's one thing I want to try. The other thing I want to try is copper and zinc. Zinc makes brass, but this experiment actually has me a little nervous. Let me tell you why. A lot of people in the previous experiment making aluminum bronze thought the aluminum was going to flash boil and it was going to cause an explosion. Well,
the boiling point
of aluminum is over 4,000 degrees. I was nowhere near the boiling point. So I knew that wasn't going to happen. Also, the standard way of making an alloy is to melt the highest temperature metal first. In this case, it would be the copper. And then once that's good and molten, you take the correct weight of what you're alloying with and you drop it in. I've done that many times and there's never an issue. And I wouldn't expect there to be. It's gonna melt, it's gonna dissolve and distribute through the metal, and then you know you get aluminum bronze, okay? Well, I expect much the same with tin because the boiling point of tin is actually even higher. It's like 4,700 Fahrenheit. So I don't think I'm gonna have any issues there. Now, hopefully this is going to not give us that brittle, crappy alloy. We're gonna try it and see. Zinc. The boiling point of zinc is much below the melting point of copper. So there is the potential that if you took a piece of zinc and you submerged it in copper, it could cause, you know, essentially a steam explosion. Zinc steam. I don't know if that would be a proper term. Vapor, whatever. So this one makes me a little bit nervous. That said, I've made brass before. I've melted copper. I throw the zinc in. I think the zinc is lighter and it floats on top. It melts and then dissolves. But, you know, I throw it in as a solid. Mixing the two as molten down in a mold, I don't know what's going to happen. And I can see there would be a potential for some sort of reaction explosion, building up of pressure. I have to be careful with this one, but we're gonna try it anyway.
This is a piece of tin, and listen to this.
Most metals don't make that noise when you bend them. Apparently that's because of the crystal structure of tin. They call it crying. I think when you bend tin at high speed with machinery, it sounds more like a cry. So the tin is in this one. I'm gonna take that to 550. That's 100 degrees above the melting point. This one I'm gonna take to 2100, also about 100 degrees above the melting point. It's interesting, that's still liquid. The tin melting point is so low.
I get a lot of comments on safety. In my view, safety is a personal decision. You know, you need to decide how safe or not safe you want to be. That's up to you. A lot of people see me pouring metal in shorts, and they seem to think that I'm crazy. I have a feeling if those same people saw me doing it wearing jeans, they would think nothing of it. I just wanted to raise a point. What do you think is the safest thing to have on while pouring metal? Well, obviously, it's flame-proof clothing. And I have some of these. These things are brutally hot. It's 95 degrees out right now. If I was using a large amount of metal, something that I was more concerned about, I would definitely use these. Now, here's the next question. This one's important. What is the second best thing to have if you don't have flame-proof clothing? Think about that for a second before you answer. The next best thing is bare skin. I'm sure a lot of you are shaking your heads right now, but it's true. The worst thing you can have is flammable clothing. If molten metal splashes on my shirt right now, it's gonna catch my shirt on fire. Metal is gonna stick to the shirt. The heat of the metal will be transferred to my skin, and the shirt will start producing even more heat, burning me even worse. I'd be much better off to not have the shirt on. The metal would hit me, the moisture in my skin would vaporize, the Leidenfrost effect would come in, and the metal would just roll right off of my skin. I'd get burned, no doubt, but bare skin is the second best thing. So, you know, when I'm wearing shorts, if molten metal splashes and hits me, I hope it hits me here and not here. The metal is going to stick to this, this is going to catch fire, and it's going to burn me far worse than if it hits me here, where it will hit me and roll off, and it'll be a brief exposure. Take a look at this clip here. You guys have probably seen it going around the internet. I don't know what metal that is, but it's pretty hot because it's incandescing, and that guy's hitting it with his bare hand and it's not hurting him. That's because of the Leidenfrost effect. The moisture in his skin is vaporizing and it's forming a barrier between him and the heat. Now, if he had a flammable glove on, that would not be going so well, would it? So just covering up your skin doesn't make you safe. So don't fool yourself into thinking, oh, I've got long pants on, I'm good. In fact, you'd be better off being butt naked than having jeans on. There's enough hydraulic pressure at the bottom that it pushed out into the sand. That's actually kind of cool looking.
It's a really interesting pattern. I rammed that sand up pretty good. I'm surprised it did this. It's kind of cool.
So this is what I was kind of hoping to achieve all throughout. Copper, bronze, and tin. And it would have been nice if that was kind of just randomly distributed throughout. That would make a really neat looking casting.
See how strong this thing is? It's not. It was poured like this. This was the tin. This was the copper. So where it's mostly tin is where it's bending and now breaking. Looks like it really doesn't take much tin to make the copper lose all of its color, because the whole thing's silver essentially. Let me sand up a couple areas and see kind of how it looks. It's fairly copper colored right there. A little more like bronze here, and then straight into silver. Now obviously this is still tin and copper alloy. That's quite hard there. Much softer out here. So yeah, I mean, you can definitely, so hard and brittle when there's a high percentage of copper, soft like tin when there's a higher percentage of tin. If there was a way to get an entire casting to look like this area all throughout, that would be really cool, but I don't see any way to make that happen with copper and tin, at least. End result of copper and tin is... It just didn't accomplish what I was hoping to accomplish.
When you see the rainbow, it actually comes in front of the ash tree. It, like, goes right into the house. And then here, it goes right into the field. It's between me and the stable. So I can see the end of the rainbow. There's nothing there!
So this is zinc.
So that's set to 900. The melting point of zinc is just under 800, so about 100 degrees above.
This is where I'm gonna put my crucibles when they're molten. I'm gonna pour right here. This is if I have any metal left over, assuming that there's no explosion and I'm not running around like crazy. I have over here, I've got some buckets of water that I can dunk myself in if I need to. I've got a fire extinguisher. As far as safety gear, I'm gonna have a face shield. I'm going to have on my flame-proof pants. They also cover the tops of my shoes. They come up to just below my chest. I don't have anything good for my upper body, so I'm gonna use this welding blanket and just wrap it around me like a shawl. So between the face shield, the welding blanket, oh, and my long gloves, which cover most of my arms, I should be pretty well shielded. So if this thing throws molten metal, chances are it's not gonna hit me. And again, I'm using a small amount of metal here. Maybe a kilogram, less than that probably. I'm a little nervous about this, but we're gonna do it anyway. Honestly, at this point, if I had to predict, I'm gonna ask you guys to predict. You know, well, what do you think is gonna happen here? I've done it before where you melt copper and then you throw in some zinc. Now, the zinc's lighter, so it floats on the surface. It doesn't get brought to the bottom quickly and in a contained area where it can then vaporize and cause an explosion. Looking at the comments, it seems there's a lot of misunderstanding as to what causes a steam explosion. The steam is caused by the water changing state because of the heat of whatever, you know, oil or whatever it is that you're mixing it with. And when it changes from a liquid to a gas, it expands. If you have a little bit of water that gets underneath your hot whatever it is you're mixing it with, and it vaporizes into gas, well, it's going to suddenly be 10 or 20 times its volume. And when it does that, that's an explosion. That sends the outer liquid flying everywhere. So that's what's going on there. If there's no state change, you know, if the water just goes from 0 degrees to 99 Celsius really quickly, that's not going to do anything. That's not going to cause an explosion. And that's why aluminum and tin are not going to cause an explosion, because their boiling point is so much higher than the copper that I'm pouring with it that there's just no way for it to flash into vapor. Now, the zinc could flash into vapor. My prediction actually is that this is going to be anticlimactic, but obviously I don't know and I'm taking precautions. What's your prediction?
Comfy. Okay. Can't hesitate because everything's cooling off. Alright, don't explode, baby. That's kind of cool.
I pour leftover metal into this ingot mold that also makes round stock that I can turn on the lathe if I need to. You can see the molten metal cooling and contracting as it cools into the center of the mold.
I'm still alive.
Look how that copper shrunk right down the middle. They both did it quite a lot, actually.
This is kind of interesting. You can actually see pure zinc over here, pure copper over here, but then you can see where it was kind of reacting and sputtering in the center.
We're going to look at this more in just a second. First, a word from our sponsor, me.
If you guys like this video, or you've seen some of my other videos that you liked, or maybe even save you some money with some tips or something, consider supporting the channel. There's a bunch of links in the description. As easy as going to buymeacoffee.com and supporting me that way. Join me on Patreon. A lot of different ways to support the channel. We're trying to grow it, and I hope to keep making lots of really good content for you guys.
This is a success. This is actually very similar to what I had envisioned. This area I shined up, you can't see it very well unless it reflects some white so that you can actually see that. The camera really loses it. But there's definitely copper mixed with brass, mixed with zinc. But I have to say, quite surprised. I did not expect this to work. I really kind of entered this saying, I'll give zinc a try, I'll give tin a try, and we'll just verify that it doesn't work, and then I can rest easy knowing I tried. That's honestly the outcome that I thought I was going to get here. Discovering something as common as zinc and copper making brass actually does this, I am really shocked that I have not seen this before. This seems like something artists would be using to their advantage, because it's an interesting random kind of organic pattern. I'm hoping with ceramic molds it'll give a much smoother finish than this, and it won't even need shined up. Now, I wire brushed that, but that sand is embedded kind of in the metal there. But you can really kind of see the varying colors and the sort of random pattern. Yeah. So no shit bronze. I mean, this stuff's plenty strong. It's it's not cracking up. Certainly strong enough for something decorative or something like a vase. Yeah, I think we're gonna have to move on and try some other things. So who would have thought? Good old brass, zinc, and copper. Hope you guys enjoyed. Check the next one. We're gonna do some more with this.